Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel, and today we'd be talking about Article of the Week. Now this is a new series, so I want to introduce to you what Article of the Week is. Basically, I read a lot of articles, that's actually 7, in a week, and I simply pick the one which I resonated with the most. Now I'm from a psychology background, of course, things which talk about psychology will obviously be given some kind of preference, and today we would be talking about this one, Theater of the Mind. Now it was published in Psychology Today, of course. The link to the original article would be given in the description box below, and of course this is not a replacement for reading this article on your own. This is just my view on it, and I would also be giving you some sort of detailed analysis, but of course I like to keep these things upfront. So here is the upfront conclusion of what I learned from this article. I really like what I have written down here. So what exactly did I learn? Well, I learned that a dream is a toddler going through a room of crayons as he tries to club those which look alike together through trial and error. Now, of course, this is some sort of metaphorical way of looking at it. This is not exactly, these words are not exactly found within the article. But let's jump into it and we would see what we find during the detailed analysis. So the author basically talks about something which he calls next up. Network exploration to explore possibilities, which basically means that we dream to strengthen different kinds of associations in our brains, which are so weak that while we are consciously awake, we do not exactly notice them. But whenever we go back to sleep, these associations are formed and they help us in solving our chief concerns in some way. Now, of course, these dreams and these associations do not solve our problems directly, but through a very indirect process. Now, we all know that there are a few dreams which are archetypal in nature, which means that almost all of us have had at least one or two of those: being chased, being naked, being murdered, murdering someone in fact. Now I'm not saying that you are doing something very wrong if you're murdering somebody in your dreams. I'm just telling you that we've all had those kinds of dreams at some point in your life. I hope, because I've had those, and if other people have not had those, then that tells you a lot about me. So there is one thing that we can pinpoint. Whatever the purpose of a dream is, it certainly cannot revolve around with us remembering the dream. Because we all know that we dream multiple times throughout the night, and we do not remember all those dreams. We in fact remember only fragments of the latest dream which we were having right before we woke up. Of course, the purpose of the dream has got nothing to do with us remembering the dream. It's something that is happening while we are dreaming, and then by the time we wake up, the purpose of the dream is already over. Now, there have been multiple people who have talked about this. There has been, of course, Freud, Carl Jung, who have talked about repressions and, you know, sexual fantasies coming out in the dream and how the unconscious manifests itself. Then we have the activation synthesis hypothesis by McCauley and Hobson, who believe that our neurons sort of fire weirdly in our pontine reticular formation, that's a part of our brain, and when those neurons fire, our frontal lobe has this weird kind of job of picking together a story. So basically these neurons are firing in our brain, and our brain needs to construct a story, you know, forcefully to explain why this firing is happening and what is exactly happening. And that's why we get all those weird dreams which sort of remain disconnected. We do not understand what they're all about. One moment you're on top of Mount Everest, the other moment you're swimming in the Mariana Trench. It can be anything, to be very honest. And then of course we've had Finnish philosopher Antti Raivonsio, who claimed that basically what dreams were doing was that they were specifically putting us out there in threatening situations while being within the safety of our dreams, and we were being exposed to danger so that our responses get incrementally better at responding to threats. And then of course we are rehearsing our social networks, our social systems with which we form friends and we form new connections. Then we had somebody like Ernest Hartmann, who proposed that dreams were basically giving us a chance to relive a certain traumatic event in our life, and it is the brain trying to provide itself therapy of some kind. So this is basically the brain trying to provide itself sleep therapy, which means that we are being actively exposed in increments to the danger, the trauma that is, but we are safely within the confines of our own dream. Of course, it wasn't until the fMRI and MRI researchers came into the limelight that we actually realized that the brain was actually playing a major role in how memory forms. And the way it actually forms is that whenever there are weak associations in your brain, while it is dreaming, sort of links them all together, right? So some things get associated with other things. It's almost as if those associations are not even consciously experienced by you until they have been linked together in a dream. For example, you may really love your girlfriend, but then you see her sister in your dreams with you. Now, you may have never consciously thought about, you know, hanging out with a sister or replacing her with her sister. I really hope you have not. But on the other hand, your brain is sort of that one friend who always pushes you to do absurd things by saying, hey, you know, what if we did that, you know? And that is what your brain is trying to tell. And then you sort of get to relive the fantasies of life in some way through these kinds of dreams, and the physiological response you have, the disgust you feel, sort of reinforce your moral, ethical framework in some way. We know that memories are linked in the form of neurons across our brain. So every time we sort of reimagine the past with different kinds of association, for example, what if that one third grade teacher who hit me was replaced by my friend? How would I feel about that? Your dreams give you a way to check up on your emotional responses towards situations and sort of understand your past better, sort of understand your fantasies better by replacing the people in it, you know. So the brain consistently asks you questions about, if not X, then what if it was Y? Well, that's it for this one, guys. And of course, some of you might be interested in reading the summary that I have put out, and I'd be attaching it down in the description box as well. Now, I would try to be consistent with these series. I try to be consistent with YouTube as a whole. I know that currently we're at 993 subscribers, if I'm not wrong, which is a huge number for me, because I never took YouTube so seriously that I should be given this kind of an opportunity so early on. I mean, I started uploading somewhere back in July 2020, and then I stopped uploading somewhere around November 2020, and ever since then my subscriber count has simply grown, right? And it grew from somewhere like 800. So if I'm gaining like 200 subscribers in a span of three and a half months with little to no input in terms of content, then I would be pretty grateful for that. And thank you so much. Keep watching. Take care.